Okay, the next item of business is a statement by John Swinney on public sector pay and emergency budget review update. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on John Swinney, Cabinet Secretary, for around 10 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, the cost of living crisis represents an unprecedented challenge. Families face a winter where they cannot afford to heat their home. Businesses face energy bills they cannot pay. Parents are struggling to feed their children. That is the reality of the cost crisis. And while we are a long way from its full effects being known, the Bank of England last month set out the reality that the United Kingdom is facing a recession as deep as the 1990s and as long as that following the 2008 financial crash. That is the context within which the First Minister set out the programme for government yesterday. She confirmed that we will extend and increase the child payment in November and protect the roof over people's heads with a rent freeze and a moratorium on evictions. Free school meals will be rolled out further, the fuel insecurity fund will be doubled, rail fares will be frozen until at least March, and the Warmer Homes Fuel Poverty Programme is being widened. This all comes on top of the almost £3 billion in support already budgeted for and an existing £800 million of relief for business in this financial year. The UK Government holds reserve powers over energy, over tax, over the bulk of benefits, over business support and over regulation that could help address this crisis. They have borrowing powers and the ability to deploy financial instruments that can transform household and business budgets. They have all of this, yet as the crisis has worsened, there has been no substantive action taken to help people and business. Urgent action is overdue, and I urge the Prime Minister and the Chancellor not to waste another day before setting out their plans. Presiding Officer, today I will update Parliament on the impact of the cost crisis on the public finances and the steps that we will take to keep them in balance while funding the support it is in our power to provide. This is not just a cost of living crisis, as some characterise it. The cost of doing business, the cost of third sector support, and the cost of public services are all rising as well. Indeed, in all of my experience now and during my previous tenure as Finance Secretary, there has never been a time of greater pressure on the public finances. Our budget was based on a UK spending review that simply did not foresee the levels of inflation that are now a reality. Last summer, inflation was just 2%. In December, when the budget was agreed, CPI stood at just 5.4%. Now it is more than 10% and predicted to go higher still. The result is simple. Almost every cost government incurs has risen. At the same time, our budget is now worth around £1.7 billion less than it was in December. That alone would require the budget to be revisited. But in times of crisis, the job of the Finance Secretary is not simply to balance the books. It is to find the money to help families, to back business, and to fund the priority projects that improve lives for the long term. And so the emergency budget review must both identify funding to cope with inflation-driven cost increases and aim to support those who most need our help during this crisis. And it must do so using only the fixed powers of this Parliament. Our total budget is fixed. We cannot vary income tax in year. Our reserve funding is fully allocated. We have no legal ability to borrow to fund day-to-day spending, such as pay increases. Our capital borrowing is allocated for projects such as new schools and housing, projects which support employment and invest in our recovery. In short, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Budget is at the absolute limits of affordability. So today I will set out to Parliament the initial steps the Scottish Government has taken and will take to manage the nation's finances while maximising the support we make available to help those in need. Firstly, let me quantify the demand arising from public sector pay. As the First Minister set out to Parliament yesterday, in the midst of a cost crisis, our role in pay negotiations is to maximise the support to the lowest paid as a crucial part of our response to the cost crisis. My job is not to fight low-paid workers' pay claims. My job is to fund low-paid workers' pay claims. Accordingly, we've seen police officers agree a 5% deal, while on ScotRail, ASLEF has similarly settled at 5%. Negotiations with some of the largest workforces, NHS Agenda for Change, for example, are ongoing. But the enhanced pay offers that have been made, excluding direct local government contributions, total approximately £700 million. Last week, we also reached a proposed local government pay settlement. As a result of our intervention and the hard work of the unions and their members, the pay rise proposed for the lowest paid was significantly increased, with awards in excess of 10%, while the increases for the most well-off were capped at £3,000. More money for the lowest paid, funded by the Scottish Government. The proposed settlement means, however, that we must find additional savings. We said there was no more money, and there is not. Funding this agreement means taking money from elsewhere. Pay is not the only cost pressure we face. We have rightly given a warm Scottish welcome to people displaced from Ukraine as a result of the illegal and ongoing Russian invasion. Almost 18% of all displaced Ukrainians coming to the United Kingdom are coming to Scotland. That requires us to find around £200 million not planned for at the time of the budget, just as the invasion began. I hope no one in the Chamber begrudges that support. Public sector pay and the cost of supporting displaced Ukrainians, along with the rising costs due to inflation, are therefore placing enormous strain on our budget. In addition to these factors, there is our clear determination to support those who will find themselves in difficulty this winter. We have already provided almost £3 billion of support to people, and as the First Minister set out yesterday, we will go further. I have heard and am listening to proposals for further action, doubling bridging payments, freezing rail fares beyond March, more help for energy efficiency, greater businesses and third sector support, and managing the impact of rising energy and food bills on hospitals and schools. None of that can be done without reducing planned spend in other areas and on other programmes. Presiding Officer, difficult choices must be made. There is no unallocated cash. There is no reserve that has not been utilised. Every penny more on one policy is a penny less on another policy. I have therefore today written to the Finance Committee setting out around £500 million in reductions in planned spending and forecasting that we have made in recent weeks. These include a reduction of £53 million in the budget for employability schemes, utilising funding of £56 million generated by the ScotWind clearing process, funding that will be reinstated in future years and used as planned to invest in the just transition, £33 million deferral of ring-fenced agricultural funds to be returned in future years, and whilst not impacting eligibility, taking a risk-based forecasting approach based on demand of a reduction of £37 million in the budget for concessionary fares. Throughout this process, we've taken those savings that we consider have the least impact on public services and on individuals. Still, these decisions have not been easy, and they will not be without consequence. In particular, the reduction in employability funding. But given the circumstances we face, they are unavoidable. At a time of acute labour shortages, historically low unemployment and soaring inflation, we've taken the view that we must prioritise wage increases over spending on employability. But this is not a decision we have taken lightly. It is a decision we would not have wanted to have taken. Any changes to budgets will be formally set out to Parliament in the budget revision process, but it is in the public interest that underlying savings are set out now so that the scale of the challenge we face is clearly understood and no one in this Parliament or anyone negotiating pay deals can be unaware of it. Many of the individual savings are small amounts of money, but together they add up to a significant reduction in expenditure, enabling that money to be invested in addressing the financial challenges we face. Last week's intervention by the Scottish Government in the local government pay dispute demonstrates what we are having to do. In order to shift to full consolidation of the award, further savings had to be made. I have committed, Presiding Officer, to publishing the outcome of the emergency budget review within 2 weeks of the UK fiscal event planned for later this month. Further savings will be required to balance the budget, particularly if inflation continues to rise. And the majority of our spend cannot be changed at this stage of the financial year, it is contractually committed or supports vital programmes. In short, what I have set out today is just the beginning of the hard choices. There is one further point which Parliament must reflect on, and which is why I require time following a UK fiscal event before I can set out the results of the emergency budget review. For 8 weeks, we've heard the new Prime Minister talk of unfunded tax cuts that will not help the lowest paid or those reliant on universal credit, and of cutting public sector spending to deliver tax cuts for businesses. If in pursuing these policies, the United Kingdom government reduces the budgets of any portfolios where we have devolved responsibility, then the challenge we face becomes harder as our budget becomes smaller. This is the harsh reality of a fixed budget and limited powers. The Scottish Government simply does not have access to many of the levers that would provide the greatest support in this crisis. Taxation of windfall profits, regulation of the energy market, or borrowing. That is why the new Prime Minister and her new Chancellor must take action immediately. They have reserved the powers over this crisis to themselves. So my appeal to the United Kingdom Government is to cancel the energy price rises and fund the targeted support people desperately need, help families struggling to feed their children and heat their homes this winter, provide the additional funding necessary to meet the impact of higher public sector pay and inflation. We will do everything we can. We will make the hard choices. But only the UK Government can act to end this crisis. They should do so, and I encourage them to do so now.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 40 minutes for this, after which we'll need to move to the next item of business. And I would encourage any member wishing to ask a question to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call first Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement as I begin. There was, however, one word missing from this statement, and it was sorry. Sorry to the people of Edinburgh and Scotland for the impact which these strikes have had on their lives, especially here in the capital where waste, Deputy Presiding Officer, has piled up in the streets of our capital city for 12 days during our showcase Edinburgh festivals. Now, Scottish Conservatives warned SNP ministers during the passage of the SNP Green Budget that councils across Scotland would be put in a position where they're unable to meet pay demands. Ministers didn't listen, and after year-on-year cuts to councils' budgets, were limited in their ability to address these local issues. Just this year, local councils have faced a cut of £251 million in real terms. Now, the Cabinet Secretary has stated today that the Scottish Government is providing £3 billion. However, a report by the independent Scottish Parliament Research and Information Centre shows that only £490 million of support has actually been put in place since October of 2021. I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary does not want to mislead Parliament, so I hope he will correct the record today. But can I specifically ask two questions? It is clear local government need a new funding settlement, something which for 15 years this government has failed to deliver. Can I ask if he will look again at a new cross-party discussion over local government funding settlements in the future? And the Cabinet Secretary today has announced £53 million of cuts from employability fund schemes. That is such an important part if we are going to face a recession of getting people and saving jobs in Scotland, at the same time as this SNP government is keeping £20 million aside for a referendum. Will the Cabinet Secretary today rethink that, invest in jobs, not a referendum?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I deeply regret the inconvenience that was experienced by members of the public in Edinburgh over the disruption about refuse collection, as I regret it in other parts of the country. I think the ability to address the issue and to avoid industrial action would have been helped if Conservative leaders in COSLA, when the government put more money on the table, hadn't voted to offer a 3.5% increase to workers, as opposed to the 5% that the government had made it possible to be funded. So the playing of politics by Conservative leaders in COSLA directly caused the industrial action in the city of Edinburgh, and Conservative leaders should be ashamed of themselves. I'm very on local government funding. The local government settlement for 22-23, before the additional resources the government has put up, increased by 9.2% in cash terms or 6.3% in real terms. So that's a very substantial funding increase for local authorities. In addition to the point, Mr Briggs should know me well enough to know that I would never put myself in the position of misleading Parliament, and it's a disgraceful suggestion for him to make of that. I will happily put in spice the substance of the list of support that the government is putting in place to assist in the cost of living that has been wrestled with by members of the public. I have it in front of me. It totals £2.968 billion, and I'll happily put it in spice. And Mr Briggs should be careful about who he accuses of misleading Parliament. I'm very happy to take forward discussions about the funding of local authorities. Indeed, the Cabinet has agreed to embark in discussions with local authorities about the questions of the funding and the achievement of outcomes, the role of ring fencing, so that we can engage with local authorities on the questions of flexibility. Now, on the point about employability funding, and I was explicit in my statement, I would rather not be making that reduction in public expenditure, but I have no other choice. I have got to, if there is, we're operating in a fixed budget, and this is the point I was trying to make in my summation to the debate yesterday, and I make again today. We are in a fixed budget. There is no other pot of money we can go to than to take money from existing commitments that we have just now. So that is why we have taken the decision on employability. We think it is a reasoned and rational judgment because we are experiencing historically low unemployment, we have significant inflationary pressures, and it is likely that the requirement and demand for employability services will be low for the remainder of this financial year. That may not be the case in future financial years, which, as we look at the impacts of this. But of course, the United Kingdom government could act to stabilise the situation, which I hope they do. And lastly, on the question of the allocated resources for the referendum, my statement is focused on this current financial year. The commitment to spend £20 million on an independence referendum, which for me is necessary to ensure Scotland can decide our own future and get out of this unhealthy and unsatisfactory arrangements of the United Kingdom, is expenditure that will be spent next year. So if Miles Briggs wants to engage substantively on the arguments about the challenges of this financial year, let's talk about this financial year, not next financial year.
Thank you. I know we've got allocated a little more time to reflect the wide interest and the number of members that want to participate in this session, but it's going to require shorter questions, but also shorter answers, Cabinet Secretary. Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank the Deputy First Minister for advance sight of the statement. Families and businesses across this country are already feeling the pain of rising energy bills, which is why Scottish Labour have been calling for active measures and welcome the fact that the Scottish Government have come to agree with many of those pledges. And we appreciate that the Government itself is not immune to these pressures as we face what is an unprecedented economic crisis. But of the £500 million worth of cuts specified today, the Deputy First Minister is also hinting at £1.7 billion larger figure. We need greater clarity. And just on the £3 billion figure of support, the Deputy First Minister doesn't need to place anything with Spice, because Spice themselves have already done the analysis and said that only £500 million is since the rise in energy costs. The rest predates those rises. If the government does face difficult choices, but if that's to be anything other than a euphemism, we need greater clarity, transparency and honesty. So can I ask the Deputy First Minister, what is the total value of the funding shortfall that the Scottish Government is planning for? Given his predecessor suggested that headcount would need to be reduced across the public sector by 30,000, can he confirm that this forms part of the plans? And given the scale of the cuts the Deputy First Minister seems to be implying with the £1.7 billion figure, can he set out what plans he's asked civil servants to examine and when he will confirm both when they will be put in place and the timelines for implementing them.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm not quite sure where Mr Johnson gets his £1.7 billion figure from, but you know, I'll happily engage with him on these questions. The substance of the challenge that we face is about the rising costs within budget lines. The £1.7 billion point I made was about the value of our budget because of the impact of inflation. Clearly, we are managing the challenges within that overall budget figure. The additional cost of public sector pay, I estimate, well, I've cited it to Parliament today, on the basis of existing offers, is about £700 million. Now, that is a substantial sum of money that we have to reconcile within a fixed budget. So what I've set out today takes us substantively towards addressing many of those challenges. Now, Mr Johnson asked about some of the references within the resource spending review to headcount. None of my predictions of the years to come would affect, at this stage, the contents of the resource spending review, but we will of course have to turn the resource spending review into individual budgets, and that will be determined by many of the decisions that are taken by the United Kingdom Government on the contents of their budget for the next financial year. So if I reiterate a point that I made within my statement, if the UK Government, for example, reshapes the balance of their budget between what they expect to generate in tax and what they intend to deploy in spending, that will have an effect on our budget without a doubt, and that may then require us to revisit some of the assumptions in the spending review. So the budget process will go through the normal process of parliamentary scrutiny. The autumn budget revisions will go to the Finance Committee in due course, and there will be the opportunity to fully scrutinise all of the changes that I'm making. So the point is why I'm here today, is to offer transparency around the changes that we are having to make. This would not be a statement that would ordinarily be made at this stage in the parliamentary year, but I'm here because we are having to take operational decisions of such magnitude that we have never taken before, that I've come to Parliament to make this statement and to address the questions from members.
Thank you. We've now taken 10 minutes to do two questions. We've got 18 members who want to ask questions and half an hour in which to ask them. So we're going to have to pick up the pace a bit. With that, I call Willie Rennie.
Whilst £82 million of what the Deputy First Minister calls savings is actually Barnett consequentials from the UK Government, can he provide more detail on precisely the impact of the other cuts to the budget? Because he's given us broad outlines, but I think people deserve to know what the real impacts will be on rural communities, on training funds, and of course also on employability schemes. So can he give the people who are going to be facing these cuts a little bit more detail about what those impacts are?
Cabinet Secretary.
I understand the aspiration that Mr Rennie sets out, and of course we will engage in parliamentary scrutiny on these points and answer and address any questions that members have on these points. We are obviously taking, the one point of reassurance I would give at the outset is the government is trying to take a set of decisions that minimise the impact on individuals. Now that will not be possible in all circumstances, but we are trying to take decisions to minimise the impact on individuals and to make judgments about when we think it is appropriate for us to reduce funding with the objective of minimising the impact on individuals.
Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Liz Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I believe that all MSPs are keen to see everyone in employment paid more, given rocketing inflation. However, given the financial straitjacket of devolution and real terms cuts to Scotland's budget of 5.2% this year, even before inflation spiked, what are the implications for the sustainability of Scotland's public finances going forward? And is the Scottish Government looking at whether or not it can continue to mitigate UK cuts in reserved areas?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the impact of the higher, the expectations of public sector pay in the budget were 2%. We are obviously at an increased level to that, and that obviously, if it's consolidated salary increases, that will flow through into future years. So that will place increasing pressure on future years' budgets, which is why we have to restate on an annual basis the contents of the resource spending review to take account of those factors. So that puts increasing pressure within the Scottish Government's budget, And as Mr Gibson highlights in his contribution, we don't have the range of flexibilities to expand the size of that cake. Obviously, these decisions will be reflected on by the government as we look at the contents of the budget, but we believe it's vital that the type of support where we mitigate the actions of the United Kingdom government, particularly for people who are vulnerable in our society, that we sustain that expenditure to protect our citizens in their time of need.
Thank you. Can I remind members that wish to ask a question to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible? I call Liz Smith to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you. With tomorrow's announcement from the UK government, there is the possibility that the Scottish Government will receive additional funding as a result of the tax cuts down south. So can the Deputy First Minister confirm that the Scottish Government would use that money, should it happen, to fund tax cuts for hard-working Scots to avoid us being the highest tax part of the UK?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think I'll perhaps wait till I see all the detail before I decide what the tax stance of the Scottish Government and the proposals are going to be. We'll see what the contents of tomorrow's announcement are, but I reiterate my point to Parliament that if there is an approach which rebalances between tax and spending within the United Kingdom, I would imagine there will be an impact on the spending power of the Scottish Government, and that is an issue that Parliament will have to wrestle with and wrestle with very carefully.
Christine Graham to be followed by Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Deputy First Minister, in your statement, we were reminded that the bulk of benefits are reserved to Westminster, in particular state pensions. Incidentally, I don't think it's a benefit, but an entitlement. 40% of those entitled to pension credit do not claim. It's been like this for over a decade, and that is a gateway to other benefits, and it saves the Treasury billions. As the UK Government is not pushing these claims, maybe deliberate, can I ask what the Scottish Government can do, despite this being reserved, to help Scottish pensioners claim their entitlement, which makes such a difference to so many?
Cabinet Secretary.
This is a very important issue, and it's one of the areas of work that's taken forward by the financial advisory services that the government funds around the country. There is advice available to members of the public. There is obviously a question about awareness and the degree to which people are aware of these opportunities to supplement their income entirely appropriately. And I will take forward the point that Christine Graham makes to ensure that our advice agencies are aware of the importance of encouraging awareness about these opportunities.
Mark Griffin to be followed by Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's local government which usually takes the hit when it comes to government cuts, and the country has seen the impact of £6 billion cuts over the past decade. Can the Deputy First Minister say what the impact is going to be on local councils and local communities of this review?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I indicated earlier on, in the local government finance settlement for this year, there was a 9.2% cash terms increase for local government and a 6.3% real terms increase. That's before we got to the additional money that I've put into local government as a consequence of the pay deals. So local government, in a very tight financial settlement, is being well supported. As I indicated in my answer to Mr Rennie, we are trying to minimise the impact of any judgments on individuals and communities, and that will be the approach the government continues to take as we look for ways to ensure that we are able to support those who are facing the greatest challenge from the cost crisis.
Bob Dorris to be followed by Pam Gosling.
Presiding Officer, the workforce in the third and voluntary sector play an important role in delivering key services across Scotland, often in partnership with government and local authorities. Today's announcement will have an impact directly on them, I'm sure. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the pay and other financial pressures on the sector, and what can the Scottish Government do to support the sector at this hugely challenging time?
Cabinet Secretary.
I acknowledge the significance of the third sector and its importance in providing the support to individuals which we saw during the COVID pandemic and which is ever more necessary just now during the cost crisis. So the sector will be under the same financial pressures the government is under. Our ability to support the sector to a greater extent is an issue we will keep under constant review as we look for ways to try to ensure that we can maximise the support that's available to provide resilience and capability within communities to meet the effects of the financial crisis that we face.
Pam Gosling to be followed by Stephanie Callan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Deputy First Minister agree that if the Scottish Government hadn't wasted hundreds of millions on ferries that don't float, on the malicious prosecution of Rangers, and the delays with the sick kids' hospital, of course, other botched SNP projects, then he wouldn't be announcing the £560 million cuts and he's announcing today.
Cabinet Secretary.
Bluntly, no. Because most of what Pam Gosler talked about was capital expenditure. And you can't use capital expenditure to pay folks' salaries. It's just not possible. So can we... So I'm very happy to answer questions in Parliament, but it would be helpful if they were slightly more relevant to the realities of life.
Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Paul Sweeney.
Presiding Officer, the Deputy First Minister has today outlined hundreds of millions of savings that have to be made for the Scottish Government to offer that enhanced pay offer to public sector workers. And nobody wants to see these savings made, but we've heard how the Scottish Government's fixed budget is falling in real terms under Westminster, so we don't have a choice, and Mr Briggs might want to think on that. Does the Deputy First Minister agree with me that not only do we need Westminster to urgently provide additional funding, but we also need independence to put future decisions firmly in the hands of the Scottish Parliament, not the Tories at Westminster?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the... Presiding Officer, the cost crisis illustrates the limitations of this Parliament's ability to deal with changing and dynamic circumstances. We saw during COVID where the United Kingdom government extended its financial interventions to quite an extraordinary level. And they did that, and that was welcome. But that was necessary in that moment, and it is necessary now. But it would be better if we were able to take the decisions in this Parliament, as an independent Parliament, about the choices that our people need to face, and to be able to have those controls at our disposal and not wait for the UK Government to hopefully take decisions that will assist us in our endeavours.
Paul Sweeney to be followed by Ross Grier.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. At this very moment, as the Cabinet Secretary outlines £500 million of cuts, public corporation Scottish Water has reserves of almost £500 million following their price hike earlier this year, a rise that looks set to happen again next year. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary whether he has demanded that public corporations with vast reserves play their part in easing the financial pressures faced by millions of Scottish households by holding down utility bills and investing in capital projects such as public district heat networks to get houses, public buildings and businesses off the gas grid?
Cabinet Secretary.
I certainly expect all public bodies, including public corporations, to play their part in assisting the government in wrestling with the unprecedented situation that we face.
Ross Grier to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you. There have been a number of claims made in recent weeks about the status of the Scottish Reserve. The Deputy First Minister referenced the Reserve in his statement, but could he expand on that and clarify exactly what the status of the Reserve is at present and what's been allocated from it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, at the statement that Mr Arthur gave to Parliament for the Provisional Scotland Reserve position at the end of the financial year, the expectation was that the Reserve would hold £650 million. The Budget Bill envisaged that £511 million of that would be... the Budget Bill provided for £511 million of that to be inserted into the budget, and we expect to deploy the remaining £139 million at the autumn budget revisions to support announcements that have already been made to provide assistance to different aspects of public policy in the course of the work of the government.
Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Russell Finlay.
I welcome that tackling the cost of living crisis is front and centre of the Scottish Government's programme for government. However, in comparison, the UK Government has been missing in action, causing anxiety for families and businesses, not only in my Aberdeen Donside constituency, but across the country. Can the Deputy First Minister advise whether the new UK Government has contacted the Scottish Government to outline needed emergency plans to help tackle the cost of living crisis?
Cabinet Secretary.
I have to say, nothing has reached me yet, Presiding Officer. That's not to say that there hasn't been approaches about some dialogue, but nothing has reached me at this stage. As I indicated to Parliament yesterday, both the First Minister asked the previous Prime Minister to arrange Four Nations discussions on the cost of living emergency. That was turned down at that stage. And I've been in touch with the former Chancellor, and I have written to the new Chancellor overnight requesting urgent intervention to address the very issues that Jackie Dunbar has raised.
Russell Finlay, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary today reveals almost £10 million will be cut from the Justice Budget. At today's Justice Committee, Police Scotland voiced very real concerns about SNP cuts resulting in fewer officers on our streets. Now, without hearing the usual stock excuses of blaming the UK Government, can he tell people why jeopardising public safety is the right thing to do?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I wouldn't countenance jeopardising public safety, and I don't think it helps the quality of debate for Mr Finlay to go chucking around accusations like that. I would remind Mr Finlay that crime in Scotland is at a 40-year low just now, and we properly and effectively fund the police service. I'm very pleased that the Justice Secretary has been able to secure a 5% pay increase for the police officers. But the whole purpose of my statement today is to indicate to members of Parliament that there are limitations on the resources that we have available to us, and we are going to have to make hard choices. But as part of those hard choices, I'm very pleased that our police service serves us so well and we have such low levels of crime in Scotland today.
John Mason, to be followed by Katie Clark.
Thank you. It seems to me that some organisations, some businesses and perhaps some individuals have been making huge profits both during COVID and through the energy price challenges. So does the Deputy First Minister support the idea of a windfall tax, and is there anything the Scottish Government can do in that, or are we dependent again on Westminster?
Cabinet Secretary.
There are, as ministers have made clear, very strong arguments for windfall taxes, and we have supported measures that have been taken forward in that respect. We believe that out of the proceeds of a range of different activities, if there are windfall profits, there is an argument to consider whether those should be the subject of additional taxation. Mr Mason will appreciate, I think, though, that issues of corporate taxation are reserved to the United Kingdom Parliament, and the Scottish Government has very limited scope to be able to take forward any issues of that type. We can, of course, explore any issues that may arise through the non-domestic rate system, but that, I would stress, is very much a peripheral approach to the tackling of the scale of the issue that Mr Mason raises with me.
Katie Clark, to be followed by Annabel Ewing.
I've listened carefully to what the Cabinet Secretary has said about operational decisions for this year, but Scotland's two richest families have as much wealth as the poorest 20% of the whole population. What work is being done to look at how the Scottish Parliament's existing tax-raising powers, for example, land-based taxes, could be used to target the super-rich, whose wealth has increased substantially during the pandemic?
Cabinet Secretary.
There are ongoing discussions that the government takes forward in looking at the exercise of the tax powers over which we have existing competence. The conclusions of those discussions will feature in the budget proposals that are brought forward later on in the year, and obviously there will be the opportunity for members to scrutinise those. There are very limited opportunities for the government to extend beyond those existing tax responsibilities, but we look at all of these questions as part of our efforts to ensure the public finances are sustainable.
Annabel Ewing, to be followed by Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Deputy First Minister touched on some of the steps which the Scottish Government is currently taking to mitigate the cost crisis. Can he provide any further detail as to how the Scottish Government will maximise the current direct financial assistance available to those most in need, taking into account, of course, the financial straitjacket that the Scottish Government is subject to in terms, sadly, of the current constitutional settlement?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think in answering Annabel Ewing's question, I would cite as probably the most recent and significant intervention in this matter, the Scottish Child Payment. The Scottish Child Payment represents a very welcome and highly focused intervention to support families facing financial challenge and difficulty. We set out yesterday that it will be extended in November, that the payment will be increased, and that is one example, and there are others I could list, where the government is taking action to support families who are facing challenge, and to do that, and in doing so, it forces us to make choices about how we use our resources, because if we fund the Scottish Child Payment, we are not able to fund other proposals and services that other people may wish us to fund.
Douglas Lumsden, to be followed by Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Deputy First Minister confirm that no budget has been taken from this year's allocation to the Just Transition Fund for North East and Moray, and that every penny of the £20 million from this year's budget will be allocated this year?
Cabinet Secretary.
There's no money been taken from the North East Transition Fund. Whether all of it will be allocated this year is a matter that will be subject to ministerial decision-making in the course of this year. But we would want to see that money allocated in full for the remainder of this financial year.
Paul McLennan, to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Normal independent countries have and will be using extensive borrowing powers to ease the burden of the cost of living crisis. Can I ask the Deputy First Minister what progress has been made in discussions with the UK Government in regards to more flexibility within the existing fiscal framework, particularly around additional borrowing powers needed now more than ever?
Cabinet Secretary.
We are in what I would call the foothills of discussions about the fiscal framework, and there are some mountains yet to be climbed. So we will be raising and discussing these issues. What response we will get from the United Kingdom Government will be a matter for further consideration and explanation to Parliament. But I think this crisis and COVID illustrate the necessity for the Government and Parliament to have a wider range of financial powers and flexibilities to enable us to manage the challenges that we face.
And Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you. The Deputy First Minister will be aware that before COVID, people with disability in employment was less than the rest of the United Kingdom. COVID has left many disabled people behind. These cuts in employability training will affect the most vulnerable disabled people in our society. What message do you just give to disabled people in Scotland that they are not important in regard to getting back into employment? And will he rethink, particularly around disability?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I hear Mr. Balfour's point, and I understand it, and I think he makes a fair point. But the challenge I face is that I can't spend money twice. That's the point we're reaching because of the pressures that we are facing. So I hear what he says. I'll explore what opportunities there are to try to address the issues that he raises. But we are under severe financial pressure, and to meet the costs of public sector pay, we have to take the decisions that we are taking. I will try to minimise their impact on members of the public. That's the assurance I've given Parliament today. But the wider context for our financial pressures is set by the parameters in which we're operating from the United Kingdom Government. And if those were to be relaxed, then I would be in a position where I could allocate more money than I'm able to allocate today.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can I just observe that the response to my appeal to pick up the pace was absolutely exemplary and has set the standard for the rest of the session. With that, we conclude this item of business. We'll be moving on to the next item of business shortly. There'll be a brief pause to allow the front benches to change.